Welcome to EconTalk, part of the Library of Economics and Liberty. I'm your host, Russ Roberts of Stanford University's Hoover Institution. Our website is econtalk.org, where you can subscribe, comment on this podcast, and find links and other information related to today's conversation. You'll also find our archives, where you can listen to every episode we've ever done going back to 2006. Our email address is mail@econtalk.org. We'd love to hear from you. Today is March 26th, 2020, and my guest is journalist and author Sarah Carr. She writes on education and is the education team leader for the Boston Globe. And she's the author of Hope Against Hope, Three Schools, One City, and the Struggle to Educate America's Children, which is our topic for today. I want to thank Plantronics for the Blackwire 5220 headset that Sarah's using for this interview. Sarah, welcome to EconTalk.
I'm really happy to be here with you.
In November of 2019, I interviewed Terry Moe about how Hurricane Katrina brought change to the New Orleans school system, creating a network of charter schools. And Terry was very supportive of that change, thought it was very effective, although fell short of what it could be. But he's definitely a champion of that change. And more recently, I spoke to Robert Pondicio for EconTalk about his book, How the Other Half Learns, which is the story of Eva Moskowitz and the Success Academy in New York City. In a few weeks, I'll be interviewing Diane Ravitch about her new book, Slaying Goliath. And I hope that these episodes with yours, Sarah, and maybe some more down the road, will give listeners and myself a rich set of perspectives to consider when thinking about charter schools and educational reform. So let's start with what you did to write your book, Hope Against Hope, which you wrote, by the way, I think around 2012 and began writing in 2010. So it's been a while. It's a very, very fine book. It really lays out the different narratives about education in America and shows that the reality on the ground is probably a lot more complicated. It's an entertaining book, not just educational. I cried a couple times. Let's start with what your plan was in writing this book. What did you do on the ground to get the insights that you write about?
Sure. Well, at the time, which was a decade ago now, I felt like there was a dearth of on the ground perspectives and takes on what was happening with school reform and the growth of charter schools in New Orleans in particular. And so I decided to embed to the extent possible at three very different charter schools in the city. And to roughly spend a year or two following a student at one of the schools, a teacher at a second, and a principal at a third. And I knew that I wanted one of the educators to be a veteran educator who had been in the system long before Katrina. And I wanted one to be a relative newcomer. There was a big growth in Teach for America teachers in the city after the hurricane. And the student ended up being a high school freshman. And so one of the schools where the student was at was a KIPP school, which a lot of people consider kind of emblematic of school reform nationally. It's a very college prep focused model, which grew quite a bit after schools reopened in New Orleans. Another school was not a KIPP school, but shares a fair amount in common with KIPP. That one is called Psi Academy. And the third was quite different and was called O. Perry Walker. And that was the one that was run by a veteran New Orleans educator, the principal, Mary Laurie. And that school was much more like a traditional New Orleans school had been before the storm than the other two.
And the three schools all have something in common. I think this is a sub-theme that runs through your book and woven through the book in a very, I think, powerful and effective way, which is the student population that the three schools draw on is very poor. And the students in those schools face incredible challenges at home and in their non-school life that the school is struggles to cope with.
Yeah, no, and that, I mean, that ended up being a big theme of the book. And, you know, I'd written about education for years before I started work on this book, but it was still eye-opening to me, just the impact that these out-of-school factors had. You know, the KIPP student that I followed for a good chunk of the year, her family couldn't afford New Orleans rents, and she was living in a pretty far-out suburb where it could take her 2 hours to commute in by bus. And that's going to impact her ability to focus on school, her ability to participate in activities after school, the family's exhaustion level. And that was just one example. These kinds of issues came up again and again and again, and in some ways in much more life and death ways.
Yeah, there's death in the book. There's issues of just violence generally on the streets. There's family challenges with work and putting food on the table that many of us listening and don't have to deal with. So the schools struggle to cope with that, even though in theory they're in school. Those students, they're not dealing with that, but you can't separate it. You can't get away from it.
Yeah, no, that's very much true. I think that there's a false dichotomy that's emerged in the debate about school reform. You know, that particularly I feel like it's maybe lessened some in recent years, but in the time period that I was working on this book, there was just this false dichotomy between sort of schools can do it all and we just need to sort of take kids out of these troubled, distracting environments and focus 100% on preparing them for college and helping them pass standardized tests, versus there's all of these outside of school factors. Schools are never going to be able to make much of a dent. Mentality. And I just felt like both of those were really simplistic. And to the extent that they shaped policies in some places, had really harmful effects.
How would you describe the state of the New Orleans public school system before Katrina? You do that in a couple places in the book. Give us your take on that.
Yeah, first, just as a disclaimer, I did not move to New Orleans or report on the schools at all until after the hurricane. But certainly at the Times-Picayune newspaper and in spending 7 years there and many years working on the book, I interviewed and met numerous people who did have firsthand experience in the schools. They were really abysmal overall. They had horrible results. If you looked at the rate of students from that system who were going on to graduate college, it was in the single digits. It was not setting kids up for on the most part for any kind of long-term educational or life success and stability. There was even a perverse idea about it that it had sort of been left the way it had been, partly just for economic reasons, because the city needed this supply of low-paid service industry workers. If spending time there, you could kind of understand that mentality more than I ever thought that I would. There were bright spots. There were, like in any big system, there were amazing committed educators before Katrina. I met many of them who were working in the schools after Katrina. There were kids who did really well. I mean, you can't speak too generally, but on a whole, looking at the results, they were pretty devastating.
So let's talk about the tangible things we can measure. One of the things I love about your book is that you are sensitive to the fact that not everything that is of value can be measured, which is a big challenge, I think, for the reform movement in general. The impulse to measure is Not a bad one. It's a good starting place, but often I think it's the end. But let's at least start there. On the tangible things we can measure in the aftermath of Katrina, there appears to have been dramatic improvement, although it still falls very short of what we would hope would be possible. Is that a good summary?
Yes and no. I think that during the time period that I was reporting and writing about the schools, which went up through 2014, I left the city and moved to New York City in 2014, there was growth in standardized test scores that was very encouraging and promising and important and a good first step. But I really think, and you're just starting to see some of the data and sort of interrogation of this question, that that the school reforms there should be assessed in the long term. And many of these schools stated as their mission that they're going to get first generation college graduates, and I think they should be held to that. And we should be looking 10, 20, 25, 50 years out at whether that's really happening. And I think some of them have struggled to come through on that. I mean, there was a story that published a few months ago on Psy Academy and its first graduating class and the fact that there were just a handful of students more than 6 years out who made it through college. And I think a lot of them are, the schools are finding it harder than they had originally thought and hoped it would be.
So on the, going back to the tangible part, the numbers that Terry Moe reported were that I think something around 25% of students in the New Orleans public school system. And remember, these listeners, I want to remind listeners, charter schools are public schools. They're just run differently, but they're publicly funded. The 25% before Katrina, 25% of students were, I think, satisfactory or passing state level tests, and that number got up to at least around 48% in the aftermath of Katrina. Then it plateaued. 48% is a terrible number, but it's twice 25 almost. But of course, what you're pointing out, which I think is the harder question, and there are many related harder questions to go with this, but what you're pointing out is that we don't really care about test scores. I mean, it's a good starting place, but and if they're abysmal, as they were, it's alarming. But if you're able to double them, but no other impact comes through on people's lives, such as the college goals that are the stated goal of this, so many of these schools, that's it's very troubling. And it suggests that we're putting too much of a burden on these schools, or that they're simply not focusing on what they ought to be focusing on.
Yeah, no, I, as I said, I don't want to sell short. I mean, test scores are not, they're not meaningless, but they're just sort of one piece of the puzzle, and one piece of what a good school should be thinking about. And I mean, one of the issues that I saw when I was there, and I think this is, I hope it's changing, is just that there were these two very divergent school profiles. There were schools that employed mostly young white newcomers to the city, a lot of whom had ties to Teach for America, and schools that employed mostly black veteran educators who had worked in the schools before Katrina. And I don't think you saw enough merging of those two school profiles to draw on the strengths of both. And very simplistically, the new schools tended to be much more strategic about prepping kids for the standardized tests. But I think that the old, and I'm putting this in quotes, schools, just knew a lot more about the backgrounds and had a much more organic connection to the students' home lives and cultures for obvious reasons. And I mean, when you look at Psy Academy, one of the schools that I followed that has had some pretty promising test score results some years, but has struggled in those early years to get help support students through college. I think that some staff who were much more connected to the kids those early years could have helped counsel them to make college decisions and choices that were maybe not as prestigious, but better fits for them and more likely to be sustainable places where they could thrive and not feel alien.
Yeah, it's incredibly very powerful parts of the book where you talk about one of the students, the one you followed, going off to college campuses. And I mean, college is really different from high school, but a college campus is particularly different for a kid coming from a very poor neighborhood in New Orleans. It's another world. I mean, it's as you say, it's an alien world. And I felt the fear that I would have felt in her shoes and in my stomach if I were trying to make that transition. It's dramatized actually in the musical In the Heights, that challenge of being the different kid who's going to try to make it in a different world. And it's so many dreams riding on it from parents and neighbors and the kid themselves. And they're not really prepared. It's way too easy to say, oh, they need a mentor program or a counseling program while they're there, or, you know, some help with how to deal with college note taking and assignments. And it's a much broader set of challenges, it seems to me.
Yeah, no, and I think also, I mean, it sounds touchy-feely, but I think it's vitally important that you can't underestimate the importance of trust and of buy-in. And all sort of the best intentions in the world can't substitute if you don't have that fundamental trust between students and their educators. And just as one example, there was one student who I met through reporting on the book who ultimately attended college for a semester and left, who said that they felt like the school that they had attended, the high school, was really just about the numbers and that was what they cared about. And they never really believed that the school cared about them as an individual. And that's, I mean, it was kind of heartbreaking to hear that. But I think that first step before you can really do anything is building trust with students.
Now, there's a lovely quote from the book. You say, many of today's leading school reformers, like McKinsey consultants, believe the results of almost everything from a child's success to the impact of a given social policy can be quantified and boiled down to a set of numbers in a PowerPoint presentation. I think that's a great insight. I think it's true way beyond education reform. It's a general issue that analytical people struggle with, that touchy, you call it touchy-feely, but it's a huge part of life. Trust, affection, love, respect. These are things that can't be quantified. And student success on test scores, again, not irrelevant, but if it's the only thing, and if the students perceive it as the only thing, It's you get a very, very different set of results. I want to read another quote from the book that I thought was kind of summed up some of the challenges we've been talking about so far. You say, you're talking about a school called Kip Renaissance, which is one of the schools you were spending time in. In some respects, the education reform movement had asked Kip Renaissance to accomplish the impossible. To educate teenagers traumatized both by Katrina and the daily realities of life in a city with decrepit physical infrastructure bare bones welfare services, inadequate health care, grossly oversubscribed mental health and drug treatment programs, one of the nation's highest violent crime rates, and corrupt, at times racist, law enforcement. Even after decades of neglect in these other areas, the most diehard advocates of educational change believe schools should be able to compensate for all that they could, acting in isolation, educate poor children into college and mainstream middle-class lives. Expand on that, if you would.
Yeah, no, I think it goes back to what I was describing as this false dichotomy that I felt like was impacting the debate to an unhealthy degree, and it was the schools must do all versus the schools really can't sort of touch these bigger issues. And I believe that the truth is in the middle, but that there were. You know, there were a lot of young educators who I met who had been kind of pumped up with this savior mentality, that there was sort of no problem that they and the schools couldn't solve. And I think that was unhealthy for them and ultimately harmful for the students as well.
It seemed there was something incredibly poignant about it. The sense of responsibility that the teachers were encouraged to take and did in fact take at times. And I sense this in Robert Pondicio's book as well, that, I mean, these are incredibly idealistic, devoted people. They're spending 80 and 90 hours a week. You know, they're young. They've got a high energy level. It's great. But they're spending incredible amounts of time trying to save these drowning students, these people who are not just challenged in their classrooms, but outside their classrooms. To say it's a Herculean task is to, I think, understate the challenge. You know, we had Paul Tough on the program a while back, a few years ago, talking about Jeffrey Canada. His book was about, the book we interviewed him about was about grit, which I think is a lovely idea, but not so implementable. But that was what that book was about. And in passing, he discusses the Harlem Children's Zone, Jeffrey Canada's approach, which is instead of just saying, well, we'll build a great school, Jeffrey Canada's approach is that that's not enough. It's got to be a full court press. It's got to be about parenting. It's got to be about after school. It's got to be outside of school. It's got to be a very holistic approach. And I think you seem to come to a similar conclusion.
Yes. And I mean, I just think it can't be tackled through the schools alone. Sort of the one fundamentally big change that really happened in my eyes to affect the lives of poor families after Hurricane Katrina. But you had incredibly high gun violence rates, and you had parents with just incredible economic and housing stability. And you just can't expect that, except in really rare cases, that schools are going to be able to kind of inoculate kids from this broader society. I mean, the student that I followed for that year, who was 14 and a high school freshman at the time, she had a very loving, supportive family, but even she, you know, experienced gun violence right outside of the apartment building where she was living with her family, and had food insecurity and housing insecurity, and all these other issues. And she was just very, very average and typical of the experience there. And so I just think that school reformers, and politicians, And policymakers need to attack this issue at multiple dimensions. And to Jeffrey Canada's efforts, which are just really laudable in so many ways, I just think there also needs to be an assessment of just doing it in ways that are not paternalistic, and where there is going to be that buy-in and trust from the community in the long term.
Let's talk a little bit about discipline, which is a big theme of the book. Whether that school that ninth grader is in was, you know, you talk many, many times with her and her parents, and trying to figure out as the year goes on, it kind of spirals downward. Discipline's falling apart. They can't decide, should it be tougher or looser? The kids start to get resentful. And one of the challenges of this corner of the charter school movement, which is, you know, the Success Academy in New York is certainly of this flavor, as is KIPP, they don't just have a certain pedagogical approach. They're going to, you know, I think of it as sort of a, you know, shock treatment. It's, we're going to jar these kids, shake them up. We're going to give them, they're going to wear a uniform. And it's not just a uniform. It's highly specified. We're going to make them walk in a certain way when they go down the hall. Classrooms are going to have a certain cohesiveness through call and response, through various norms that are developed through the teacher's instruction that make a lot of people very uncomfortable, both white and black, but particularly for black kids being taught by white teachers to conform in certain ways to what some would call white culture, it seems a bit oppressive. And it's certainly, of course, for teenagers, there's a lot of things that are in high school that are oppressive. But talk about that challenge and how you saw that unfold over the year.
Yeah, well, it's a very discipline in that context was an incredibly complicated, multifaceted issue, because the KIPP-style discipline is not white culture. I mean, you don't see schools with 95% white kids where they're being asked to walk on straight lines down the hall and sit up straight and make eye contact. That's a phenomenon of predominantly black and brown schools. And as a nuance in that, there were a lot of New Orleans families who liked structure, who wanted structure, who felt like the schools before Katrina had not been structured enough. And there were a lot of old school veteran New Orleans educators who still supported corporal punishment. So it's a very complicated issue, but adding to that is that you have these schools that are predominantly, if not exclusively, white led, imposing these strict standards and rules around bodily comportment on predominantly black kids, and that takes on a different and potentially racist look and truth. It was given the complexity, it was really challenging to write about, but KIPP Renaissance was definitely one of these places where you saw that very rigid approach go awry, because you had a lot of families who supported it in theory, but when they saw how it played out, grew much more skeptical, and there was the erosion of that trust.
That's one of the challenges, and you write about it. It's in very even-handed ways. It's a first-year school, right? It's run by a young, incredibly idealistic, incredibly hard-working principal, with a bunch of teachers who haven't taught much, some not much at all, who don't come from New Orleans, most of them, don't know anything about the culture, don't know anything about the lives their students are leading outside of school. And it'd be absurd to think that's going to go swimmingly the first year. What I like about the charter school movement a great deal, and what I would like about it, a different version of it, which would be one that would not even necessarily have government money in it, that would be a truly voluntary school system. But what I like about it is that, you know, parents can vote with their feet. You're not stuck going to the school in your neighborhood if you don't like it. It's true. It might mean you're on an hour-long bus ride to get to it, but at least you have a little bit of choice. And most importantly, the schools that can't get it right, never get it right, fail, either because they lack trust of their, they can't generate the trust that helps, or they do a lousy job on that tension between discipline and freedom for 14 and 15 and 16, 17-year-old adolescents. They have trouble attracting parents after a while. And so schools that are horrific close down. In the current system in most American cities, horrific schools just keep going. Does that give you any, does that encourage your support of this flawed but maybe better charter school system?
I mean, I would push back on some of that because I think it's a, I think it's a view that makes a lot of sense in theory, but the way it plays out is messier. Like I'm not defending schools that sort of fail kids year in and year out, staying open by any means. But what the upshot of sort of all of these policies and practices in New Orleans seem to be, I mean, the recruitment of young idealistic educators not from the city, the close schools down if they don't succeed, you know, hold them rigidly accountable to standardized test score benchmarks, the parental choice, seem to me to just be chronic instability. Like you just don't, I can count on one hand the number of people I know who were leading school buildings when I lived there who still are. And that's a problem because you need to worry about the results, but you also need to worry about building relationships and building institutions that families have some understanding of. They can't exercise choice in the way that we want them to unless they sort of know what these institutions are.
I think that's a great point, and I do think it's underestimated by economists like me who sometimes champion charter schools as some kind of magic bullet or school choice as a magic solution. Having said that, you know, it leaves us with a really unpleasant choice, the stability of a bad system, which is what we had before, versus a more chaotic and troubling system, but one that does lift more children out of despair. Now, one of the lessons I think I take from your book is that it's not so many. Even though your book isn't data rich because it was early, you've alluded to it earlier in the conversation that when we look down the road at whether kids with high test scores get into good colleges, stay in good colleges, graduate from good colleges, and enter adulthood in a responsible and productive and flourishing way, it's deeply discouraging. Now, we've talked about how it's a multifaceted problem. You know, my simple take on this, and maybe it's too simple, is that this is better than what we had before. We need more of this, not less of it. I know that's a painful thing to say, given its relative ineffectiveness, perhaps, and I don't want to be overly pessimistic about that. Maybe it's going to get better yet, but I vote for change.
I think it's another false dichotomy between that static old system and this dynamic, always changing new system. I think there are ways in New Orleans from the outset that they could have worked toward something that would have been more stable, but that also would have been more accountable and dynamic. They could have looked more aggressively and done more to nurture local or at least southern charter school leaders and and networks. They could have not greenlit schools where 100% of the teachers were under the age of 25 and white. there were a lot of things that they could have done, I think, that would have led to more accountability and more change and more dynamism in the system of schools without creating this chronic instability.
I think that's a great point. And I think for me, that makes me even more optimistic about the value of a charter school approach. There's trial and error. I want to add one other thing, by the way, which I'm sure you would agree with, which is it's really hard to run a school. It's so hard.
It is.
And it's really hard to be a high school teacher. I've mentioned it many times. My wife teaches high school math, and it's a life for people who have a calling, the ones who do it well. It's a craft. It's an art. It's an act of devotion when done well. And what I hear you saying is that, there's a lot to be learned. What I would argue in response is that this system can learn. There are people who might start off as teachers who fail, principals who fail. It may be chaotic and turbulent for a while, but the trial and error approach that the charter or more private voluntary approach champions allows that to happen. The old approach, which is the top-down, more one-size-fits-all school board-run system, yes, it's local, but it's so sclerotic. So I take your point that the charter school system has a lot of drawbacks in its early years of implementation, and maybe for a while, and maybe they made mistakes. But we could look; the people involved could learn from those. I don't see that happening in the public school system in the other major American cities that struggle with urban public schools.
To learn, though, you need some stability of people, and there are folks that I've interviewed who are pro reform and pro charter school who say that you can build the really successful school where there's major teacher turnover every 4 years, as long as you kind of have this pipeline of energetic, talented, hardworking folks coming in. I don't believe that. I don't believe that that's the way a successful school operates. And you can't have this mass turnover in personnel at all levels and really kind of learn and change from the lessons of the near or far past in the way that you need to. One of the big takeaways for me to one of your earlier points of writing this was whether it's a charter or a non-charter school was the power of principals, and just that there's that it's an incredibly hard job, and it takes this really unique, diverse skill set, and that we don't have enough of those people, and the people that we do were often burning out far too quickly. And I don't have a solution for that, but it clearly stood out to me as one of the big problems of urban school reform.
I think that's a great point. I think your earlier point about turnover, quote, every 4 years in the Success Academy in New York, it's more than every 4 years. And I think one of the challenges there, it comes back to your earlier point, and it's very powerful to think about the breadth of the problem. So you have this idealistic 24-year-old, 25-year-old, 22-year-old who turns down the New York finance job, investment banker job, the high-paying consultant job to do something that speaks to the heart. They find that just like working at McKinsey, it's 80 hours a week, but your level of control is much smaller. Your successes are going to be smaller, and not everybody can do it. They are going to burn out. And so we have this turnover that makes it much harder for these schools to acculturate a staff that grows and learns and helps these students flourish. Mm-hmm. And I think the lesson for me, which I hadn't thought about sufficiently until I read your book, is that that 80-90 hour thing, I mean, my wife works much more when she's teaching a full load, would work many, many more than 40 hours a week. But there's some civilization in it, at least. But for these young teachers you're talking about, it's a brutal slog, and it's full of explosions around them, fires to put out. It's just it's hard to improve even over the course of a year. Some do, but it seems to me that a lot of that is that desperate attempt to fix this one corner. You know, so many other things are going awry in these young people's lives, and the burden of overcoming all that is in the 8 hours that they're in that building, and on the 23-year-old who's trying to light a fire under them that is so hard to light for all kinds of reasons, including their own ineptness and inability to relate to the lives of their students, picking the wrong books to talking about them in the wrong ways. I mean, there's just so many challenges. It just seems that an effective school has to do something that is more integrative. I think about going back to the Success Academy, the burden that it places on parents is very high. And, you know, what I took away from Robert Pondicio's book to some extent was the ability of a school to cherry pick, not students, but parents, to mm-hmm. cherry pick families. And unless you do that, and unless you find ways to help those parents help their kids, it's going to be really tough. And almost everything we try will fail, it seems like.
Yeah, no. And I mean, a lot of the parents are just experiencing such incredible stress. Up until this current crisis with the coronavirus, we had...
We're taping this in the middle of the coronavirus for listeners who may hear this weeks, months, or years later. Go ahead, Sarah.
We had such record low unemployment rates in places, but that doesn't mean people are getting living wages. And I just think that's an issue we just don't think about is the strain of constant economic and housing and food insecurity on the families that are attending the types of schools that we're talking about.
And as you point out, I think that's, by the way, listeners know, I think that's a really hard problem to solve, but many people disagree with me. I think there's easy ways to pass a living wage law, but I think that's going to, in my view, cause more harm than it's worth. But that's not the scope of our conversation today. But the general point that you have a parent, if you're lucky, two parents, but often one parent, that one parent didn't finish high school, or if they did, wasn't a very good high school. They have a child who's in a high school that might not be ready to fit them for success. And really hard to break that cycle. And some of the desperation and relentless cheerleading and bravado that these schools try to build around going to college as a savior is, I get it. It might be the only way that breaks many of these families into a different path, but it is not a easy path to get on.
No, that's definitely true. And I think a lot of the, particularly the early charter school educators underestimated the complexity and what they would need to have in place to successfully get kids on that path.
When you wrote this book, as you say, it was about the work began a decade ago. Did it change you? And have you kept in touch? When I say did it change you, you've talked some about the things you learned, but did it change you in other ways? Did it? Have you kept up with some of the people in the book? I actually Googled some of the names for fun and see that they what they've gone on to do. Some of the young people, of course, have moved on to different career paths or related career paths, but not the same ones they were on when you wrote your book. But how did this book change your attitudes and your soul?
It did. I mean, because while I talk about you know, the importance of trust from the educators in the city at that time, I was working really hard as a white outsider myself to build my own trust with each of the story subjects that was hard and fraught. And I had written about education for more than a decade when I began work on this book, but never in this sustained way and never writing about individuals' lives in such intimacy and for so long. And so to the extent that it's changed me, it sort of taught me the value of that. And I really feel like each of the main characters in this book has enriched me personally and enriched my thinking about these issues. So I feel very fortunate as a journalist and a person to have had this experience. And yes, I'm still in touch with many of them, which has been really wonderful.
Well, you recount many conversations in the homes of the people that you're writing about, certainly in the offices of the principal, not just, you know, it's not like you just went and interviewed a principal about their experience. It's, you used the word earlier, you were embedded. How many hours a week were you spending on this project, and how long did that last?
The year that I was reporting the book, I had a fellowship at Columbia University, a Spencer Education Journalism Fellowship to support me. And so it was a crazy year because I had some commitments to be at Columbia. And in literally all of the time that I was not at Columbia, I was in one of these schools or with one of these characters. And so that was probably the most insane year of my life because I had some degree of flying back and forth between New Orleans and New York City and was myself working 90 to 100 hour weeks. But I did find that the school observation time was really incredibly useful and vital. And particularly, I think, in the Psy Academy reporting where I followed the young teacher, that played a heavy role. But with the principal and the student, the interviews that I had outside of school hours were just as much, if not more, crucial at times. And I was particularly appreciative of the student and her mother's willingness to kind of just digest together kind of what was going well and what wasn't at the school with my listening in that year.
And I'm just curious, on a logistics basis, were you recording those conversations? Did you just take notes? Because they're incredibly powerful. They're conversational. They're not just, you know, what you remembered or what you summarized from those conversations or experiences. There's an incredible drama that plays out over the course of that year, as these, you know, and it's one drama of hundreds is what's so poignant about it. How'd you get that material? And were they uncomfortable? Did you struggle to get someone to agree to that? And that's true across all the, you know, both the principal, the teacher, and the student.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I recorded key conversations, but I was just in schools and doing interviews so much that I quickly realized that I would never get this book written if I was trying to go back through transcripts and listen to audio for all of them. So I really relied on notes, and the strategy I relied on the most was taking written notes as fast as I could during the interviews and in schools, and then working late in the evenings to type up my notes while my memory was fresh. If I hadn't done that, it also would have prolonged the process because it gave me a lot of ideas about sort of questions to go back in. It gave me sort of a searchable document at the end instead of a bunch of separate notebooks with handwritten notes. So it was a low tech process, but I think that the most important thing for me was just typing up my notes at the end of each day whenever I could. And in terms of, there were things that different characters in the book had a lot of ambivalence about whether they wanted them, and that we had to really talk through in some cases over a period of months. And I had to sort of take these were not public figures. If they ultimately decided that they did not want something in the book, that was up to them. With the student in particular, Gerald Lynn, I was very conscious of reminding her at regular intervals, if I see something or if you say something that you would not want to be in the book, to tell me. In that sense, I as a journalist lucked out a lot with her because she was just had a very sophisticated take and understanding of that in a way that I don't think a lot of 14-year-olds would have. And I remember one time when I gave her that reminder, she said, "I just don't tell you things I don't want in your book."
just like her parents. Yeah. Yeah. How was school today? Fine.
Yeah.
How have your views changed since you wrote the book? You became at some point you left New Orleans, you came to New York, you said you've been writing on education. You know, we'll link to your articles at The Globe on education. Some are related to what we've been talking about, but some are not. The world has spun forward since the aftermath of Katrina. The education wars still continue to rage. Everything's on the back burner right this minute because of the virus, but inevitably these issues will be back front and center because parents care more about their children pretty much than anything else, and they don't take failure lightly. So how have your views changed, or what have you learned that you'd think that you'd add if you were to write a postscript?
I don't think my views about school reform, which are kind of fundamentally middle ground, I would say, have changed that much. I mean, obviously charters and accountability and some of the issues that were sort of front and center in the debate during the Obama administrations have receded a bit. I mean, in a much bigger sense, having sort of lived more myself and having watched sort of how some of the people who I've followed over time, how their lives have played out, I mean, I'm just left with kind of a deepened understanding of what's at stake for individuals' lives, and also just the fragility of it all. That a lot of the work that's being done by policymakers and in schools is really life and death work in a lot of ways.
If you could impart wisdom to those people doing that life and death work, you know, I think one of the I'm going to ask you what it would be, but I think one of the challenges of this whole area is the assumption that there's a switch we can switch on or off, a lever we can activate, a dial we can turn to the right setting, and then all of our children will be like in Lake Wobegon, above average. And I think one of the lessons I take from your book is that, you know, it's more complicated. I think that's the value of the middle, the middle ground approach. But are there things that you think have been underappreciated or that you wish could be remembered more strongly in this discussion and in executing in a school environment?
I mean, there are lots of little things. I don't have sort of the grand solution. But I think not underestimating the importance of teacher diversity, and just believing people who are doing this work have to believe one fundamental thing, that it's not a choice between quality and diversity, that we can have really competent, robust, talented staffs and have diversity. And I really think there's a lot of people who don't fundamentally believe that, and that's a problem. I mean, I think at all kinds of levels, there just, as I said, needs to be a bigger discussion about principles, and building and sustaining a stronger core of principles. I think there was definitely in New Orleans a lot of lip service to this idea of sort of rigor and relationships. But I think there needs to be much more interrogation of sort of what we mean by both, both rigor and relationships. Since I'm not there anymore, I don't know the extent to which this might have changed. But I was troubled when I was reporting in these schools, at least some of them, by this kind of deliberately colorblind approach. And I think people, and particularly white people, need to get much more comfortable talking about race and racism and the role of that in everything.
Well, that's part of the relationship issue, obviously. And there are a number of examples in the book, which I enjoyed reading about, of that lip service part rather than the reality often is that's inevitably going to be the case. I think the challenge for young teachers and all teachers is similar to the challenge of parenting. We all want to be, as Adam Smith pointed out, loved and lovely. We want the approval and respect of our fellow teachers, but we also sometimes want it of our children and our students. And I think as a parent, one of the great challenges is the temptation to make sure our children like us, which can conflict with our job as a parent. And I think teachers have that same challenge. So I think navigating that relationship that you're talking about, it certainly is there in the classroom. It's certainly there if it extends outside the classroom. How do you maintain, what's the right persona? What's the right level of intimacy, friendship, support? I've often remarked on here, and I felt it deeply as a teacher myself, that you know, there is a temptation to see yourself as a tough teacher. You know, students have to earn my respect. Mm-hmm. And if you do that too much and you see grades as a way of being the stick and carrot that by which students come to like you, the students will feel that you're not on their side. You're there to judge them. And that doesn't work well. Certain students, but with other students, that's not what they need at all. And in fact, they need something very different. If you go too far in that direction, saying, I'm on your side, I'm going to give you a good grade even when you don't perform, you're at the other end of the spectrum. And I think for young teachers especially, and I'd love to hear any of you out there who are listening or dealing with this, I think that's an incredibly subtle and nuanced challenge, and a great principle can help their teachers navigate that, but it's very, very hard.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, it definitely is. And I, you know, you mentioned earlier that just what hard jobs these are. And I, believe me, I felt a sense of privilege being able to kind of write about and be invested and engaged in New Orleans education, but at the end of the day, not have a classroom or a school building that I was responsible for, because it was just, it was work that would test the most hardworking and talented of people. And that question about discipline, in a lot of cases that I witnessed in those years, the schools were, I felt, pretty undeniably too heavy-handed, but there were a lot that were really close calls. And when you had kids that were really disrupting the learning of a lot of their classmates, it's very hard to figure out the best approach.
My guest today has been Sarah Carr. Her book is Hope Against Hope. Sarah, thanks for being part of EconTalk.
Yeah, thanks so much for having me on. I really enjoyed the conversation.
This is EconTalk, part of the Library of Economics and Liberty. For more EconTalk, go to econtalk.org, where you can also comment on today's podcast and find links and readings related to today's conversation. The sound engineer for EconTalk is Rich Goyette. I'm your host, Russ Roberts. Thanks for listening. Talk to you on Monday.